There for a minute, I thought the church was going to tilt to one side, but y'all finally filtered around and got to. Well, they tell me I'm a home where no storm clouds rise. Tell me of a land far away. Oh, they tell me of a place where my friends have flown. That's pathetic, is what that was. That was pretty pitiful. It's, and it was every other one. Like y'all swatting flies. It's cause we, yeah, now we're complete. We're good, yeah. Everybody ready? A one and a two and a... There we go. Woo! Oh, they tell me of a home where no storm clouds rise. Oh, they tell me of a land far away. Oh, they tell me of a place where my friends have flown wild. Oh, tell me of an unclouded day. Oh, the land of a cloudless day. Oh, the land of an unclouded sky. Oh, they tell me of a place where my friends have flown. Oh, they tell me of an unclouded day. Maybe this will help. Oh, they tell me of a place where my friends have flown. Oh, they tell me of a land far away, where the tree of life and eternal bloom sheds its fragrance through the unclouded day. Here we go now. Oh, the land of a cloudless day. Oh, the land of an unclouded sky. Oh, they tell me of a place where my friends have flown. Oh, tell me of an unclouded day. Shoo-wee.
Boy, this front row had it down pat. Yeah, they did. No, you got a song to sing. Yeah. But they got to stand up. They can't sit down on this one.
If you're following along in your books, 335, Standing on the Promises. If you're lazy, look at the TV screen. Standing on the promises of Christ my King, through eternal ages let his praises ring. Glory in the highest, I will shout and sing. Standing on the promises of God, standing on the promises of God, my Savior. I'm standing on the promises of God.
Last verse.
Standing on the promises I cannot fall. Listening every moment to the Spirit's call. Resting in my Savior as my all in all. Standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises of God.
Amen. You may be seated.
Well, good morning. We're glad to see everybody here this morning. We welcome you to the church. And Betty, good to see you this morning, your smiling face. It's always good to see you back. And we are just so happy you are here The announcements are in the bulletin. Take note of all those announcements. In the back of the church, there's a bunch of sign-up sheets back there. So when we get up to welcome each other, you must go to the back and you must sign up on those sign-up sheets. There are several back there, including the ones for the funeral food. If you are on a list to bring food to the funeral, fine. You do not need to check that one out. But if you can and are able to provide a dish for our funerals, look at that list, sign up, and help Debbie and the Benevolence Committee out by bringing a dish. Sign up for what you can bring, and there's a list back there. And if you're one of those people who say, man, I wish I could help out, but I'm just not able to cook and bring a dish, then help us out this way. We provide chicken every time there's a dish. One of the most expensive foods to buy this day and time is chicken. So if you could write a check and just give a few dollars toward the purchase of that chicken, and on the bottom of the check, just write funeral or benevolence or something like that, it would help us tremendously with the cost of the chicken when we have a death. Now, every time a church member dies in the church, we provide a meal for that family. So if you're one of your family members passes away, we will do that for your family. So if you can help us by cooking the dish and bringing the dish, or if you can help us by helping purchase the chicken, that would be a tremendous help. So there's sign-up sheets back there, or if you could write a check, that would be great. Now, sometimes Debbie has a problem when she calls. People don't return her phone call. I know sometimes it's not convenient if you already provide a dish. It's like, you know, you just can't do it that time. That's okay. We understand if you can't do it that particular time. But just call her back and say, hey, you know, I'm out shopping. I won't be able to do that. Or I'm keeping grandkids that weekend. I can't do that. Just call her back and let her know that you won't be able to do it that weekend. But let her know back that you're not able to cook it. And then that way she can call somebody else and they can provide your dish. So help us out when we have deaths in the church. That would be a great help for that family. So that's sign-up sheets back there in the back. We got a fall festival coming up here in just a few weeks on October the 22nd. There's three sign-up sheets for the fall festival. If you're planning on cooking chili, you need to put your name on the list. Tell us that you're cooking chili. Men or women can enter that chili contest and knock Jamie off his throne, okay? So sign up on that list. We need people who will either cook, bring sandwiches or desserts we can eat that night, okay? Sign up back there. Tell us what you're bringing. Peanut butter and jelly, ham, bologna, pimento cheese. Tell us what you're going to bring that night. We don't need 150 pimento cheese sandwiches, okay? So tell us what you're going to bring that night, or a dessert. You don't have to tell us what kind of dessert, but just tell us what you're going to bring. And then there's a third sheet for those who will bring a cake for the cake auction. Do not have to tell us what kind of cake you're going to bake. Let it be a surprise, but tell us if you're going to bring a cake for the cake auction so we'll know what we have coming that night. So there's those sign-up sheets back in the back of the church, okay? Adult choir, stay afterward. There's the blessing box back there. Women's ministry, you'll meet next Sunday on October 9th. Tara and Catherine are really trying to put together a women's ministry, a ministry for the women of the church. If you are a woman, we don't need men coming to this, but if you are a woman, please support that ministry. They're trying to get this up off the ground and going and do some really neat things for the church with our women. So come next Sunday at 5 o'clock over to the community center and support the women's ministry. You know about the Fall Festival. Round Robin Revival is coming up. I hope that you'll support that all four nights. You know where to be and when to be there. And then we'll have a Thanksgiving service on November the 20th. Jamie's got something to say about the Round Robin Revival.
All right, so how we're going to do the food, we've come up with a menu. Every church is going to bring two dishes of each one. So right now what I need to do is I'm going to ask you right now, on the spot, who will bring mashed potatoes? I need two. There's one, and we're talking crock pot size mashed. Yeah, crock pot size. So we got one. Anybody else? Got Kathy and Dorothy. Mashed potatoes. Green beans. I'll bring a green bean. I like blue green. Me and Tracy. Corn. Corn. Got two. Edith and Olivia. Well, yeah, if you can, yeah. Yeah. If you can, just come and eat. There you go. We'll be happy with that. Pasta salad. Tara, Kathy. And I think we're going to do the rolls here, and we're getting a whole bunch of chicken that all three churches are going to pitch in, and then that's it. That's all of it. Boom, 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 boom.
All right. You make a donation, just throw in the pot whatever you will, okay? All right.
Dessert is whatever. If anybody wants to bring a dessert, desserts are wide open. We know we're going to have 14 tables worth of dessert. So if you want to bring a dessert, cookies, anything like that, go ahead and bring it. The church is going to provide, we'll have, you know, tea, lemonade, and water. If you want to bring something else outside of that, more than, as long as it's a soda. Never mind. Look, see, they know. I didn't even have to say anything. Yeah.
What are we doing about drinks?
What's that?
What are we doing about drinks?
Drinks? He don't listen to me. Sweet tea, lemonade, and water is what we're doing. What do you want? Anything but what he's drinking right now. See, you'll be happy with all of it. All right, that's all I needed. We're good to go.
If you'll make a donation for chicken, just write whatever you'd like to donate anytime between now and revival, write on the bottom of your check, revival, okay? So.
And other churches, Union and Lockport, are also doing just what we did this morning. So there will be plenty of food. Bring your appetites, and we'll have a good time.
What's next, Jamie? That's me. Oh, that's right. Who has a birthday or an anniversary? Who has anything good they want to say? What you want to say, Madeline?
Today's my mama's birthday.
Well, let's sing happy birthday to your mama, okay? Can we do that? Yeah, let's stand up and sing happy birthday.
Happy birthday to you, happy birthday to you. May the Lord bless and keep you. Happy birthday to you.
Hey, welcome each other to church this morning.
All the little children, if you want to come up front. All the little children.
Well, before we start, Brother Jackie asked if anybody has anything good to say, and I have something that is just awesome for me and my family. My brother has been on our prayer list for months, and we got a liver transplant Friday. And he's doing great. I talked to my sister-in-law this morning, and they took the van out this morning. So he's just doing really, really good. So I heard that you all talked about the changing of trees this morning and what that means, that God's love for us never changes. Now, in the season of a tree, what all does it do? I mean, in the springtime, you've got the new leaves. In the wintertime, they all come off. In the fall, they all come off. In the wintertime, the tree has to go through time with no leaves on it, nothing to protect it. And it doesn't get the rain like it does in the spring, does it? All right. Sometimes people say that's a time of growth. Because, I mean, you know what a tree looks like just by us looking at it. And you know when it goes through hard times, and when you know when it's going through a good time, because when it's going through a good time, the tree is all pretty, isn't it? It's got flowers on it, it's got fruit on it, the leaves are all green. And then when it starts going through a hard time, that's when the leaves starts changing colors, and it doesn't have that time of protection like it did. But what's going on underneath the tree? Kind of like an iceberg. You see so much of it on top, but what's the biggest part of an iceberg? It's below, underneath of it. And that's where the roots are for a tree. And if you saw a big tree get blown over, how big is the roots that you see over top of the ground that have pulled up? We went past one last year when we had a lot of winds, and there was probably as big as this area is up here is where the roots were on the bottom of this tree. So in that hard time of life, and in the winter time of a tree, the growth is all happening where we don't see it. It's where our roots even get deeper, because we don't. In the springtime, they got water just coming to them just straight out, don't they? Doesn't have any problem getting any water. And in the hard times in our life, and in the winter times for a tree, the roots have to go deeper and deeper to get the nourishment they need. And that's when, I didn't even use what I thought I had my Bible beside me, I'm sorry. I'm a little off this week because it's been a little trying. But when we're growing our roots and staying in the Word of God and growing deeper with Him, that's when we get to withstand those hard times in our life. And we get to enjoy when the freshness of spring comes and the world sees how we came through the hard times. And it's just how life is changing constantly, but how God never leaves us, and His love is always there for us. We just need to remember how to tap into it. So would anybody like to say a prayer for us today?
Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this wonderful day, and thank you for the wonderful ones that will come. Thank you for keeping Miss Tracy's brother safe and having a successful liver transplant. Thank you for keeping us all safe and all have a great roof over our heads and food on our plates. Amen.
Won't you stand? Three 42, if you're following along in the hymnal. Sound pretty this morning. Sure sing better than they clap, don't they? My bad. Didn't know. Try to turn away from the mic when I do that, but it don't work all the time. Family of God, 386. One more time. I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by His blood. Jesus, as we travel this sun, I'm part of the family. Amen. You may be seated. We ask now that you take a look at your prayer list. All those who are needing it this morning, if they're not on the prayer list, this is our time that we begin to worship and prepare our hearts for worship.
Thank you, Becky. Before I read scripture, let me kindly give you a rundown on our people and what's going on, best I know. Buster's going to have back surgery later on this month. Miss Joe was still having some issues at home. Dean Club had a knee replacement this week, still having a lot of pain. Logan Jewell, we won't remember her. Henny Downey is going to have some skin cancers removed later on this month. Sheila is scheduled to have the same surgery I'm having in December, I think. Helen Irwin, we want to remember Helen. Ruby Hensley, that's Amy's grandmother. She's been in the hospital but now home. Terry Lucas is recovering at home from knee surgery. My surgery is on Wednesday. Janet Oliver is going to have some eye surgery next week. We want to remember Gina. Betty, we are so glad you're here today. Brenda Rocky is going to have a knee replacement on Wednesday. Lanny Roberts is back in the hospital with some swelling, some fluid buildup. Marvin had his surgery on Friday. He's in the hospital, considerable pain. They had to take the rods they had put in last year. They had to take all those bolts and screws and rods out, replace them. He's having a good bit of pain. The plan is for him to go to Fraser Rehab tomorrow and be in rehab for a while. Sue will have her surgery later on this month. Sheila Sullivan had to have her little toe removed off her right foot, and she is at home recovering, doing well. So that's a rundown on all of our people. If you know any different, let me know. If you know anybody we need to add there, please let me know. And if you have put people on the family and friend list, if they need to be removed once they're a little bit better and can come off that list, or if they can be removed, please let me and Becky know, okay? Let's look at our scripture. To the angel of the church in Pergamon write, these are the words of him who has the sharp, double-edged sword. I know where you live, where Satan has his throne. Yet you remain true to my name. You did not renounce your faith in me, even in the days of Antipas, my faithful witness, who was put to death in your city where Satan lives. Nevertheless, I have a few things against you. You have people there who hold to the teachings of Balaam, who taught Balak to entice the Israelites to sin by eating food sacrificed to idols, and by committing sexual immorality. Likewise, also, you have those who hold to the teaching of the Nicolaitans. Repent, therefore, otherwise I will soon come to you, and I'll fight against them with the sword of my mouth. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. To him who overcomes, I will give some of the hidden manna. I will also give him a white stone with a new name written on it. I know, known only to him who receives it. May God add his blessings to the reading of his holy word. Let's pray. Father, thank you for a beautiful morning, and thank you for those who have chosen to come to your church this morning. And we ask that you open up your word that we may hear it with our heart, our ears, and our eyes, that we may be receptive to everything you have to say to us this morning. Lord, we have a long list of people in our church and friends and family, Lord, who need physical healing. We pray for those who've had surgery and are recovering, and those who face surgery, that you would be with their doctors and nurses, technicians, and everyone who will touch them in the coming weeks, that their surgery may be successful. Lord, we thank you for our children that were here this morning. Thank you for their precious little souls. We ask that you be with them as they practice their Christmas play. We know, Lord, that they're excited about it, and we're excited about it. And so, Lord, we just pray that you would just be with them and their teachers and their leaders as they work with them. We thank you so much for this church, Lord, that sits right here in the Franklin community. And there is so much work to be done here. Open our eyes that we may see that there are people here who need to hear the word of God. And Lord, we need to hear this message this morning, because, Lord, this message is for this church at this time. So may we hear what you have to say to us today. Lord, thank you again for who you are and what you mean to us. Thank you for going to that cross just for us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
So this is probably one of my favorite songs. Little disclaimer, a lot of times when I'm loading this video up on to put on our Facebook page, there's a copyright deal and it'll mute it. So my cousin Heather married into a family that is connected to the Crab family. And Jason Crab did this song. So I want it known on Facebook that if there's copyright infringement, call my cousin. We're connected. Anyway, now this song means a whole lot to me. I never do it because it's a hard one to get through. And I usually play the guitar when I'm at home, and I don't even do that much anymore. But it's about asking God forgiveness for who I was. And a conversation that I recently had was, well, you know, you're still the same guy. You're still the same old guy. And, yeah, I'm still in the flesh. I'm still the same old guy. But God made me new. And that's really hard to get across to people. And a lot of people say, well, you know, when I first started being the worship leader here, in case you can't tell, I'm kind of nervous. When I first started being the worship leader here, there was a whole lot of chatter. Look what Franklinton's doing. Boy, they're scraping ball and barrel now. Look who they got leading worship. But that's okay. I understand that. But it is my wish every single day. And me and Joey actually have this conversation numerous times, that not one person walks out the door and doesn't know Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, because I want to see everybody when we get there. I want to be able to reunite with everybody. And that's what this song kind of means to me is, yeah, I wasn't who I was supposed to be, but God made me new, and I'm here now. Sleep is gone, my heart is full of sorrow. I can't believe how much I let you down. I dread the pain that waits for me tomorrow. When the sun reveals my broken dream, scattered on the ground, please forgive me. I need your grace to make it through. Lord, all I have is you. I'm at your mercy. Lord, I'll serve you till my dying day, and help others find a way at your mercy. Please forgive me. I can't believe the God of earth and glory would take the time to care for a sinner like me. But I read in the Bible that old story, how he pled for my forgiveness while he was dying on a tree. So please forgive me. I need your grace to make it through. And Lord, all I have is you. I'm at your mercy. And Lord, I will serve you until my dying day, and help others find the way
need your grace to make it through. And Lord, all I have is you. Lord, I'm at your mercy, and I'm gonna serve you until my dying day, and help others find the way at your mercy. Please forgive me. Please forgive me. Please forgive me.
I just need to say amen and let's go home. Jamie, if you thought a few eyes turned when you came here, I can't go home. People still can't believe I'm a minister or pastor. I used to do a lot of what you did, not sing, but well, I was a coach. But I got thrown out of more ball games and turned over more tables and kicked more basketballs than you'd ever believe. Oh, yeah, a few buckets, yeah. Even got kicked out of a softball game one day for saying Sam Hill. And kid ran from second base to third base on the fly ball with one out. And I asked him, I said, what in the Sam Hill you think you're doing? And the umpire said, you're out of here. And I said, what did I say? He said, you told Sam to go to hell. I said, I did what? You just don't understand my southern dialect. So before I left that softball field, I turned over a 55-gallon trash can and kicked every soft drink can in the can all the way to the car. But, I've been known to have a temper, so people still can't believe I'm a preacher. Awesome song. I told you there's three parts in every church. Now, we're going on up the coastline. Jamie's got the map up there. You'll see we're now up to Pergamum, a cosmopolitan city, the capital city. Compare it to Washington, D.C. All the business took place here. All the leaders were here. You find Joe Biden here, Nancy here, you know. Mitch is up there somewhere. The accommodation, Jesus told John, says, the good thing is I know where you live. Satan, he's on his throne here. Is he ever in Washington? Yet you remain true to my name. You did not renounce your faith in me. That's the good thing about this church. Verses 14, 15, the correction. Nevertheless, I have a few things against you. You have people there who hold to the teaching of Balaam. people there who were eating food sacrificed to idols, and they commit sexual immorality. Likewise, they hold to the teachings of the Nicolaitans. We've seen that word Nicolaitans before, back up in Ephesus. Nicolaitans were people who pretended to be Christians. They were good people. They pretended to be good Baptists. But Nicolaitans ate idol meat and they practiced fornication. In other words, if God said he forgave us of our sins, and God granted us grace, right? God grants us grace, right? Then if God's going to be that good, let's just go out and the more we sin, the more God can forgive us, right? Isn't that right? So let's just, if God's going to forgive us, let's go have a real good time on Saturday night. You know, that's the problem. Let's put it this way, Baptists. Once saved, always saved, right? Isn't that what Baptists believe? Once you're dumped in the water, you're good for life. Grandmama wants me to be saved, so go down there to Franklinton, get dipped in that pool down there, and I'm good for life. I'm going to heaven. Ain't that what we believe? Isn't it? Boy, y'all quiet. We got nearly 400-something, probably over 400-something members on the roll here at Franklinton. What we got here today, 60 people. So we got 300-something people who believe that. I've been baptized. I'm on my way to heaven. We're going to talk about a white stone in a minute. Once saved, always saved. That's what Baptists believe. We're just like the Nicolaitans. The letter to the church at Pergamum could actually be called the church on trial. First Timothy 4, 1 through 2 says, the Spirit clearly says that in later days some will abandon the faith and follow deceiving spirits and things that are taught by demons. In the later days, such teachings come through hypocritical liars whose consciousnesses have been seared with a hot iron. The church at Pergamum. God opens up by saying, you have this going for you. You haven't abandoned the faith. Good. You're teaching the Bible. Some of you down there at the church, Pergamum, you got some good things going for you. You're meeting every Sunday morning. The preacher's getting up in the pulpit and he's preaching the word. You haven't forgotten it. Your worship leader, he's getting up there and he's doing his job. He's singing old hymns. And buddy, he's bringing tears to your eyes. You're doing a good job. And you feel good about what you're doing. when the hour's over, puffed up, feel good about yourselves, and you're going home because you've opened your Bible, you've read the Word, and morally you feel like you've done your job for the week. You feel good. But then in verse 14, he gets to the heart of the matter. Don't you feel good when I brag on you? But in verse 14, he gets to the heart of the matter. But this I have against you. He says, some people living with you, some people there in the church with you, don't measure up. Oh, that must be Kathy. Or that must be Jerome. Or that must be Carl. Let me look around. Who doesn't measure up? It ain't me. Surely he's not talking about me, is he? He said, some of you are holding to the teachings of Balaam. False teachers. He says, first of all, you're just putting up with those, but you're allowing them to live. You're allowing those false idols, people who are teaching false things, to dwell among you. Because you're letting people who practice wrong things dwell in the church. You're putting them in leadership positions. And you see absolutely nothing wrong with that. Boy, it's getting quiet in here. You see, in the churches today, people like preachers who pat them on the back and who preach goody-goody sermons, but they don't like preachers who preach the Word. For instance, the camera's on, isn't it? Yes, I'm fixing to get in trouble. One of the most popular preachers on TV today is Joel Osteen. Why? Tickles the ears. People like their ears tickled. He's good looking. He don't weigh 375 pounds. He's not bald headed. And he tickles the ears. People like that. But you know what? This book doesn't tickle ears. And we don't like it when it cuts like a two-edged sword. See, we have people among us and that we put them in leadership positions and we allow things to go on. And they were allowing things to go on in Pergamum that Jesus wasn't happy about. Several years ago when we first moved to Sunnyside, it was Christmas Eve and we lived in that big house. Our kids never seen anything like that. Becky had it. You know how Becky decorates. Every room decorated, there's 50 million lights. My light bill was $8,000 that month. But, but, you know, they couldn't wait to come to the big house and bring all the grandkids. Well, we didn't have grandkids then, but you know, well, we did have grandkids. Did we not? I don't know what we had then. We had something then. But anyway, they all came for Christmas Eve, and they brought friends with them. And so it was night, and we had exchanged gifts, and we're ready to go to bed. And some of their friends, you know, had their girlfriends with them and boyfriends with them, and we had a house full of people, and it was time to go to bed. And when it was time to go to bed, I said, okay, bedtime. Boys, y'all go to the blue room, and girls, you go to the pink room, and we're going to bed. And a couple of them looked at us and said, but, Jackie, we live together. And I said, you may live together, but you're not going to sleep together in this house. And they looked at me like, but it's Christmas Eve, and we've been living together for almost a year. And I'm like, you might have lived together for a year, but you ain't going to live together here tonight. And it was like, well, why not? And I said, because this is my house, and we don't do those things in my house. Now, I'm old-fashioned, right? But see, the Bible says we don't do those things. Am I right or am I wrong? But see, that's just become another way of living this day and time, right? But we've allowed it so long, it's become, it's okay. But not in my house. Several years ago, Becky works at U of L. Anything and everything goes at U of L. We were invited to a wedding between two people of the same sex. She says, we've been invited to this wedding. I said, I'm not going. She says, well, I think I've got to go. I said, you can go. I'm not going. Now, what people do in their personal lives is okay. And I have, quote, I have nothing against people who get married that are same sex. That's okay. That's their life. People live their personal lives. I have no problem with that. But I will not attend those weddings. And I will say this publicly. As long as I am pastor of Franklin Baptist Church, there will be no same-sex marriages in this church. And if I'm forced to do that, I will resign on the spot. Because the Bible says that's not to be done. These things were going on in Pergamum. Jesus says it's got to stop. The church is on trial. It must stop. We've got to get to the heart of the matter. The Nicolaitans have come in. They've moved in, and y'all have eased up on them. You say you're a church, you're a Christian, you're following my rules, but you're not following my rules. Jesus says, I am the head of the house. I am the head of the house. I am the one who sets the rules. You must follow the rules or get out. You have allowed it to go on, and now it is interfering with the rest of the church members. He says, you've been caught. And now you are busted. tolerated these things, it's time to change. You've tolerated the doctrine of the Nicolaitans, and I'm telling you, you must change. God is saying there's some stuff going on in the church that's contaminating the whole church. We've been through COVID, right? I catch COVID. I go home. Who's probably going to catch COVID next? Becky. So Becky gets COVID and she goes to visit my daughter. Who's probably going to catch COVID next? My daughter. She's got two kids. Who's going to catch COVID next? Children. See, once one person's contaminated and they take it to another person, the next person's contaminated before long. So we had to wear masks. Remember COVID? I mean, we kept passing it on to another person. Once you allow contamination inside a church, it contaminates the whole church. Joshua 24:15 says, you know, it's for me and my house. What are we going to do? Serve the Lord. Exactly. Contamination will lead you down a road of destruction. We're not Burger King. Church is not Burger King. You can't have it your way. The church is not a democracy. It's a theocracy. It's God's way or no way. It's God's way or hit the highway. You either want to go to heaven or you're going to hell. You make the choice. You make the choice. He's talking about a white stone. What verses was that? I got to get back to my scripture. He talked about, I will give you a white stone and write your name on it. Back in the day, back in those days, you received an invitation by receiving a little white stone with your name on it. If you were invited to a party, you received a white stone. To receive that white, if you got that white stone, it meant that was your written invitation. We didn't get engraved invitations like we get today. Recently, we've had weddings all over the place, and if you received that invitation, that meant you were able to come. If you didn't get an invitation, you can't come. It says here that you will receive a white stone with your name written on it. Folks, if you don't get a white stone and your name written on it, you don't go to heaven. And so Jesus was saying to the church, he was saying to the church at Pergamum, that if you want to go, your name will be written on a white stone. He says, whoever has ears, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. To the one who is victorious, I will give some of the hidden manna, and I will give him the person with this white stone with the name written on it. I know, known to the one who will receive it. He says, I know who's going to receive it. He says, I'm not putting up with those who have all the false teachings. Listen, we cannot become a church that is infiltrated with all the other things that's going on in the world. When a church preaches the word and stands on the word, the neighborhood changes, the school changes, the community changes, the state changes. We must become that church. We must decide whether we're going to stand on God's word or we're going to compromise. Are we the church at Pergamum? Look around. What have we become? What will we become? We must decide what kind of church we're going to be. What do you want to be? Do you want a pastor that preaches the word? Real soon, very soon, you'll have a new pastor. I don't know when. I don't know when I'm going to step down, but it'll be soon. You'll be calling a new pastor. What kind of pastor do you want? You want a pastor who preaches the word, or you want a pastor who tickles your ears? Do you want a pastor who will tell you like it is, or you don't want a pastor to say, "Oh, it's okay. Let's just compromise. It's okay. We'll put up with the way the world is, you know. Let's talk the talk. Let's talk the talk of the world. Let's live the way of the world." Or do you want a pastor who's going to preach the word of God? Get to the heart of the matter. The heart of the matter is the church at Pergamum was changing with the world. They were putting up with anything and everything. Everything and anything could walk through the door. They would accept any belief, any teaching. And Jesus says, "John, tell them it's enough. I will take only so much for so long. They must change. I insist that they do that. I insist that they change. And if they don't change, I will change them. I will change them, and I will see that they no longer exist." And guess what? They didn't exist for very long. They were soon gone and off the face of the earth because they continued to put up with what was going on in the world. And Jesus did away with them. He did away with them. We cannot afford to live the way the church at Pergamum lived. We must change and make a difference in the world. There's an old saying that says this, if I can find it. Well, I don't see it, so I can't close with it. It's a good saying, too, but anyway, let's pray together. Lord, thank you so much for your word. Thank you for the church at Pergamum, that we can learn from it. Thank you that we are a church that stands on the word of God, and the Lord, that we believe in what you have to say. We love you, Lord, and thank you for teaching us through the church at Pergamum that we cannot be a church that compromises, but that we are a church that stands by your word and for your word. Thank you for the letters to the churches that John has written. This morning we pray that there's one here that doesn't know you as Lord and Savior, that today would be the day of salvation for them. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. If you need to make a decision, you come forward at this time.
Won't you stand?
He passed and we
Don't forget, Jamie will be preaching next Sunday. I plan only to be out one Sunday, hopefully no more than that. But remember me on Wednesday. Brenda has surgery on Wednesday. Gene also lost an aunt this week.